Welcome, and thanks for coming tonight. I think this is, I hope it's going to be quite an inspiring and enlightening evening for you. And I'll just say a few words first about the Male Psychology Network, and also say a few words about the gender empathy gap. Many of you have been a bit puzzled by the idea that there is something called a gender empathy gap, and we'll probably not know what it is. And you might also be interested in why the Male Psychology Network will be interested in the Red Pill. So I'll just explain a bit who we are first. The Male Psychology Network, we're a bunch of people, mainly psychologists, and mainly clinical psychologists, also some counselors and psychotherapists, and also some people working in charities, things like the Samaritans. And we have in common an interest in helping men and boys with some of the issues that I think are kind of being ignored, I think, which is a fair thing to say, by mainstream psychology. I mean, that's quite a thing to say, but I think there's a bit of a problem with that. There's about 50 members of the Male Psychology Network at present. For anybody who is a psychologist here, a member of the British Psychological Society, you will have, in a couple of months' time, a letter come through your door from the British Psychological Society asking if you would like to vote for the Male Psychology section of the BPS. And you may or may not have any views on that, or maybe we'll develop some views here tonight. But obviously, I would urge you to, even if you're a bit undecided about it, do vote for it, because I think we're going to do some things that will help a lot of people. Already, we've done various things in terms of research and publications. I think we're kind of punching above our weight, I think, in terms of publications. And we've got a handbook that should come out in, I think, about 2 years' time. Seems to take ages, seems to get further away all the time. And we have our annual conference here that you see, in fact, this picture here was from the conference in June. And this is us, obviously, you can see where we're standing outside. Last year we had the conference here in this room. And in 2017 we're going to have it in a similar room, I can't remember, but it's beside the main gates of Elysium. And just a quick look for some of the other things we're doing as the Male Psychology Network. We've got a couple of free lectures coming up, so if you are interested in issues around male psychology, this might interest you. Some of the research we've been doing is based around the idea that men are not seeking help from therapists as much as they might have. I mean, men may well benefit a lot from talking to a counselor or a psychotherapist or a psychologist or something. But very often men don't seek help in that sort of way. So what we're interested in is whether there's some way that we can adapt what we do to make it a bit more male friendly. So we've been doing things like asking therapists whether they think that men and women have different needs in therapy, and whether there's different outcomes if you use different approaches with men and women in therapy. And also we've done a survey of the general public, asking men and women what kind of things they would like to have in a therapy, what kind of features of therapy appeal to them and what don't. So both of these are research projects with the Male Psychology Network, and if you want to hear about them, they're all coming up in the next couple of months. Now, onto the gender empathy gap. This is a concept that has derived from another concept related about male gender blindness. And I'll talk a bit about that first. Martin Seeger, myself, Martin's here in the audience, has done some research interviewing life coaches about whether they thought there was differences in what men and women need for therapy. And we're kind of surprised maybe not that surprised, but all of the coaches that we asked said that there were some kinds of differences. What was interesting was that a lot of the sex differences they described were not things that they talked about kind of really straightforwardly. So there was a sense that they were, in about two-thirds of cases, were a little bit apologetic about saying that, that there were differences in the kinds of approaches that men and women needed. And we thought that perhaps that might be due to do with some kind of cognitive dissonance related to talking about things that they knew were a little bit unsayable in some circles, especially in, I think in psychology we're supposed to notice gender similarities rather than gender differences. And if you're asked to talk about gender differences and you find yourself talking quite a lot about the gender differences that you see, it can make you feel quite uncomfortable. I think that we saw that in some of our interviews. And I think that, that kind of discomfort also is related to male gender blindness, which is a term coined by clinical psychologist Martin Seeger, which describes the kind of situations that we see quite a bit. Maybe we don't notice them, but we, they're readily recognizable. So for example, we have a kind of male gender blindness to suicide. So although we know that about three or four times as many men commit suicide as women, we don't really seem to take that on board in a kind of an emotional way. We certainly don't seem to kind of act as if that's a really important sex difference. So we seem to have male gender blindness for that. Domestic violence is another example. And people are often uncomfortable talking about these things, but there's a lot of evidence that the rates of domestic violence from men to women and women to men is not that different. That's a very uncomfortable thought for a lot of people. And I think we often prefer not to see that sort of those sorts of statistics or hear those sorts of things. And we make all sorts of excuses for why things aren't going that way. Workplace deaths, about 97% of workplace deaths are male. And that's something that we just don't talk about. We talk about lots of other gender imbalances, but we don't talk about things like workplace deaths or things that seem to be against men. We seem to be blind to those sorts of things. So this male gender blindness, I think, feeds into something that people are calling the gender empathy gap. And that's what we see when I call myself here. Seeing in situations where we feel less empathy for men than we would for women in a similar situation. Okay, so it's a kind of the difference in how much we empathize with a man who's suffering compared to a woman who's suffering. And I mean, I'm not asking you to sort of say, oh yes, John, I've seen all these things myself and I totally believe them. I mean, this might be the first time you've heard about any of this stuff, in which case I don't expect you to agree with this. So hopefully you will eventually, but you might be experiencing some cognitive dissonance right now. But if there is something called a gender empathy gap, here are some possible causes. What's called the women are wonderful effect. We tend to just think that women are kind of nice creatures and men are nasty creatures. If there is something of that, that seems to be quite pervasive. And so when we see a man who's suffering, we don't quite have the sympathy or empathy that we do when we see a woman suffering. This next bit of research I found quite startling. My first degree is in social psychology, and one of the things that we learned was that social identity theory predicted that whenever anybody has a group identity, it will show in-group bias and out-group bias, or in-group favoritism and out-group bias. And this type of social effect holds true across all types of identity. That's what we resolved back in the mid-90s. It turns out that it's not quite true that it holds across all identities, because it doesn't hold true for gender identity. So men don't tend to show favoritism towards other men just because they're men. This is quite a big caveat to the whole social identity theory itself, and one that we should take quite seriously, because it means that we shouldn't be at all surprised if one of us showed that much empathy for men, or find that we show much more empathy for women than men, because it's predicted from what we know now about social identity theory. And social identity theory might come from a kind of evolutionary psychology sense of male disposability. So men are just less important to the survival of the human species than women in terms of to keep birth rates at a healthy level. You need women more than you need men. And it could also be that the role of the male protector, which is a traditional gender role for men, might also relate to men being just seen as more disposable. So if you see a man in trouble, you feel less concerned about his safety or welfare. So, given that we think, or suspect quite strongly, that part of the reason that we're seeing a lack of action on the part of psychologists and other people in helping men get into therapy or helping to reduce the male suicide rate, the question arises, I mean, can we do something about it? Especially if, as we suspect, the roots of this gender empathy gap go so deep. I mean, if this is an evolutionary type phenomenon, it might be difficult to do anything about that. So is it possible to bridge the gender empathy gap? And kind of by coincidence, around the same time that we're asking this question, we heard about this film called The Red Pill. Now, The Red Pill, I'm not going to say too much about it, but The Red Pill seems to describe the story of somebody who goes from one kind of side of the gender empathy gap to the other. It's somebody who starts out